Hi, it's Klaus from Electronics Unmasked, presenting a concept and test of an inexpensive low-frequency antenna for SDR receivers. We designed and studied several loop antennas for a wide frequency range on the channel. They are working on fundamentally different principles, not always easy to understand, but fascinating. Today we are investigating one that can receive low and very low frequencies. It might be worth subscribing, and don't worry, it's for free. Low frequency signals are penetrating into buildings, water and ground. They are used for time signals, mining, tunnel and submarine radio, navigation, weather services, remote control and many other services. On special occasions, you may be able to receive the historic Grimeton VLF transmitter. It's over 100 years old and a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Really interesting. The 17.2 kHz signal is generated by an electromechanical generator and radiated via huge antennas. Typically, as DIY VLF antenna, like 100 meters of copper wire wound on a frame are proposed. Here is a suggestion that I prefer for several reasons. Our loop has only one turn. Its low impedance at low frequency is allowing electrical loads well below 50 ohms. The basic idea is now to transform the received signal to a higher voltage level using a suitable balloon. Based on our calculations, we are designing a powerful low frequency antenna now. Before we get into it, I'd like to draw your attention to some great offers from PCBWay, the sponsor of this video. They are offering PCB production and everything you need to successfully implement your project. PCBWay has manufactured our PCB antennas with great quality and encouraged us to create a collection for different frequencies. Just check it out. Take the easy way with PCBWay. A loop behaves like a voltage source with an internal impedance consisting of radiation resistance, ohmic loss and the loop's inductance. This equation is determining its impedance magnitude. The logarithmic graph is indicating its values in the low and very low frequency range. A 50 ohm receiver's input voltage is defined by this voltage divider. U0 is the loop's open circuit voltage at a certain field strength in the air. This term is the magnitude of the loop's impedance plus the receiver's input resistance. Next, we are converting the signal into dBm so that we can compare it with actual received signals on our SDR. Now the transformer comes into play. This equation determines the voltage received considering its ratio T. Okay, but what ratio would be suitable? Let's assume we want to match the yellow 1 meter diameter loop at 100 kHz. Its impedance is about 2.5 ohms in that range and transformation to 50 ohms requires a ratio of 20. Our reference loop is delivering minus 132 dBm signal at a certain field strength. With a T of 20, the same loop would deliver 22 dB stronger signals. Not bad, since we don't need any active elements. The upper frequency range is masked out because, in reality, a parasitic capacitance between the turns is causing a signal to drop we didn't take into account in the model. Here's a second example for very low frequency. At 10 kHz we need to transform 0.5 ohms to 50 ohms, requiring T equals 100. In theory, 35 dB signal increase would be possible, but we need to explain practical limitations in a minute. The nice thing about this antenna is that you can use virtually any cable as a loop. Thicker conductors have lower inductance and resistance, but this isn't a major advantage for this type of antenna. We're experimenting with two transformer concepts. The first one is a ferrite ring using 24 turns as a secondary winding. 3 turns of the thick blue cable make the primary winding. Its transformation ratio T is 24 divided by 3 equals 8. In theory, for a reference signal at 77 kHz, we should gain 14 dB. For a second variant, I'm disassembling a ferrite choke. Wrapping 10 turns to each ferrite core gives us a 20 turns secondary winding. A single feed-through isn't enough as a primary winding, because the coupling seems too weak. We're looping the cable through the ferrite core twice, resulting in a ratio of 10. In theory, this results in 16 dB stronger signals at 77 kHz. The DCF77 time signal is a perfect reference, as it's arriving with constant field strength at my location. I'm comparing now loops with transformers to a similar one without. You can hear it immediately. The signal is becoming stronger and cleaner. Both balloons are improving my low and very low frequency reception significantly. And here is the effect of the parasitic capacitance. The signals are dropping even stronger than expected in the upper frequency range. But that's not a disadvantage. When using SDR receivers, it definitely helps to avoid interference. It's really cool. I can now receive MSF, for example, the English time signal on 60 kHz. The MSF transmitter is in a distance of more than 1200 km and it isn't actually intended to serve Germany. In fact, the antenna opens up a spectrum where I couldn't receive much before in my office. Using wires I had at hand, I achieved transformation ratios of 8 and 10. For the final design, we are aiming higher ratios using thin copper wire to further improve very low frequency reception. Nevertheless, the early results provide us with important insights. The balloon with the ring ferrite doesn't reach its theoretical gain, while the one with the ferrite choke comes very close. I suspect it's due to the primary winding, where the longer ferrite core from the choke is probably achieving stronger coupling. Obviously, the concept works well with the right balloon. Although it's not yet the optimal dimensioning, the signal is more than 30 dB stronger than that of a dipole of comparable size. Furthermore, the SNR is much better. It's a big difference on low frequency. I'm now receiving many signals that were previously lost in noise. A proper DIY guide is coming, but I'd like to share a few tips for optimal dimensioning in advance. Calculations with a ratio of 100 were too ambitious. A realistic range is 10 to 50. Thus, we are reaching 1 to 5 ohms, being the ideal value for the larger 2-meter loop in orange. A quick test confirmed it. The signal is about 10 dB better than the best seen so far. I like the single-turn loop. Its shape isn't crucial, by the way. It seems you can build a powerful low-frequency antenna using simple means. We will soon publish a DIY suggestion for a combined antenna receiving low and very low frequencies. Hoping you enjoyed our video and were able to take away something for your own projects. Now stay tuned and don't forget to support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.